Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to my lecture number 25. So after the long summer break, now we will talk about biomass or bioenergy. So here you see a typical landscape in Germany in spring. It looks really beautiful, all these yellow beautiful colors. And these are fields of rapeseed for biodiesel. So this is one way how we do renewable energies in Germany. So at the first sight, it looks like a really nice way to produce fuel for cars, but let's talk about it in more detail to find out if it's really all very sustainable or not. So today we talk about biomass or bioenergy, which includes of course also biogas and biofuels. When we go back to lecture number 3, already there we said that one of the most important renewable energy sources was biomass. So that made us different from animals, that we were able to use fire and in this sense to use biomass for burning. And this way we could cook our meals and we could heat up our houses. The main source which was used, of course, was wood at that time. Here you see a landscape in the Mediterranean area in Italy somewhere, and what you will see as the first sight is there's no trees left, there's no forest left. So the deforestation is one of the effects which the use of biomass has. So this happened in this area already in the Roman Empire. At that time, the big forests which have been there were largely deforested. What was the reason? Well, of course, people used the wood for construction, for example, houses, but also very important are ships, because you know the Romans were expanding over the Mediterranean Sea and they needed a lot of ships for trading and of course also for having wars against other groups. The next reason for deforestation was the use for cooking and for heating. We heard already about the famous Roman bath, which not always were heated by geothermal sources, but mostly of course also by wood. And in the time of the Roman Empire, in some sense, there was an overpopulation. There were a lot of people in the big towns and they could not all be fed and have enough resources from the direct neighborhood. So they went into the mountains and cut the trees everywhere. Actually, the expression sustainability, or in German at least, the word Nachhaltigkeit comes from forestry, because people at the early times already realized that you should not cut more trees in a forest every year than trees grow back in the same year, because otherwise the forest becomes smaller and smaller all the time. You see the deforestation in most countries. We had it in Germany also, in Ireland, for example. Also here, the building of ships was an important part of it. And if you look to New Zealand, there you see still the original forest in some areas, but a lot of the mountains have no forest anymore. Also here, building ships from these big original trees was one effect. And of course also agriculture in New Zealand, the growing of millions of sheep. Then, as explained in lecture 5, we had the era of fossil fuels. What was the reason for that? Well, the steam engine had a double function here. First of all, steam engines needed very much fuel. At the beginning, they used wood, but then soon it was found out that there was not enough wood available, so you needed fossil fuels. And at the same time, these steam engines were able to help you to haul the coal in the coal mines. This here, for example, is an example of a steam engine which hauls coal, and this coal then could be used to run the steam engine. If we talk about biomass, we cannot go around the discussion which is called tank or plate. What does it mean? Well, as we learned in lecture 12, biomass is the energy carrier of our own life, our own metabolism. So agriculture produces the biomass, first of all, as food for humans and for animals. And if we now start to use agriculture to produce biomass for energy production at large scale, to fuel our cars, for example, then we suddenly need a lot more biomass. And then the question is, are we in competition with food production or not? Going back to lecture number two, you remember that there is a big rise of population. Our global population became so large that the only way to feed all these people became only possible through the Green Revolution, how it's called. So what we call the Green Revolution, I will explain you in a few minutes. Let's first of all talk about how much biomass is available on our planet, what kind of biomass there is, and whom we have to feed with it. So if you look at the numbers here, most of the biological living mass on Earth is from plants, 82%. Then a big part is microorganisms. They are everywhere here, also in this room, but especially in any kind of natural waters. And also in your own body, there's, I don't know, a kilogram or so of microorganisms living around in your guts and everywhere else. So this is about 30%, and then we have about 5% of animals and mushrooms, and the human beings have no real importance there. It's only 0.01%. So why talk about overpopulation when there are so few human beings? If you look at the masses from mammals, the picture looks different already. Here, human beings, if you count them to the same group, is 36%. 60% is due to domestic and farm animals. So for all the non-vegetarians among you, we eat more animals than we weigh ourselves. And what is a bit disturbing is that there is only 4% of wild animals left on our globe. So here you see already that the majority of the big animals is here on this globe for human beings, and that they make the mass of these more developed animals. A similar picture comes from the birds. If you look at the amount of mass of birds on the globe, these numbers of course are not very precise, but there were people counting them and calculating it. Here you find that there's only 30% of the birds, wild birds, and the rest is just kept for human beings to eat them. The amount of food an animal needs or a human being needs may become a bit more clear on this comparison here. If you have a buzzard which weighs about 1 kilogram, this buzzard needs about 3,000 volts a year to eat. This makes about 90 kilograms, so a buzzard eats about 90 kilograms of meat every year. And these voles, of course, they feed themselves through plants, so cereal, for example. And these 3,000 voles need 1,000 kilograms of food every year. This makes about 11 kilograms per body weight. And here you see nicely the difference of a vegetarian, which eats 11 kilograms of cereal per kilogram of body mass, whereas a non-vegetarian needs about 1,000 kilograms cereals per kilogram of body mass. So this already gives you a hint why it is maybe useful to really think about becoming vegetarian in the future. Now let's come back to the Green Revolution. What does it mean? Well, you see on this picture, one point, of course, is monoculture. And this monoculture is a kind of anti-biodiversity in two sense. First of all, if you look at the picture, you can ask yourself, where do the deer or the fox or the white boars live in this landscape? So the animals which are naturally on our planet and which make our biodiversity have a problem in this monoculture. Of course, the same is true for all the other plants. There are millions of different plants which cannot live in these agricultural areas anymore. But the second point of biodiversity or of anti-biodiversity is the plants which we use to feed the world is just basically a handful, even though there are also thousands of plants which you can eat, which you can use for feeding people. This variety is reduced to a very small number, and even inside of this small number of plants, it's a certain genetic monoculture which is used to feed the world. And of course, this has a lot of risks in many respects, but this is not subject of our lecture today. Besides monoculture, of course, the main part of the Green Revolution was the use of fertilizers. Yeah, we remember that plants consist mainly out of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, and the carbon they get from CO2, and the hydrogen and oxygen they get from water. So why do they need fertilizers? Of course they need fertilizers because there is a lot of other chemical elements which the plant needs at low concentrations, but still it needs it to grow. These other chemical elements usually come from the ground, but if you have an intense agriculture and you want your plants to grow strongly and fast and produce a lot of fruits, then of course you have to supply that from outside because the soil doesn't regenerate enough. One main chemical element is nitrogen. Nitrogen is in the air. 80% of our air is nitrogen. So why do we have to add nitrogen? Well, the point is that most of the plants cannot use nitrogen from the air because it's strongly bound in the N2 molecules. And there is only a few species which use microorganisms which are able to crack the N2 elements and bring it into a chemical form so that the nitrogen can be taken up by the plants. And these microorganisms which you need for that are not available at the large scale for intensive agriculture, so you have to put the nitrogen as fertilizers into addition. Similar things are true for other elements like kalium or sulfur and so on. So in this sense, of course, it's clear using fertilizers was a great step forward in agriculture, but of course that means you need a chemical industry to produce these fertilizers. But that is not the only thing. If you have a monoculture and if you have a high density of plants and they are all the same plants which can have the same diseases, then of course you need pesticides. So there's a whole industry of herbicides, insecticides, fungicides, bactericides and all kind of other things which kill other plants and animals just to let these plants which you want to grow at this area. The next point then is the plants need enough water. If you have an intensive agriculture on a small area, you need irrigation. Irrigation has also problems because with water you also put salt on the field, and if you are in a dry area where there's not much water, then you produce a salination of the ground. So all that makes up modern agriculture, and even though you put all this stuff onto the fields for the growing of the plants, it is still not sustainable and it's also not sufficient because you find out that in many areas the soil is leaching and there are certain parts which are important for the plants and which also make up the taste of the plants and the nutritions. They might be reduced over the long term because the soil is leaching. And at this point, I think it's clear what is meant by the tank or plate discussion. It's not only a problem of the area that you don't have enough area to produce enough food and fuel, but it's also that you need additional fertilizers, that the fertilizer industry raises the prices because there's more need than is available. And this shows you the limits of agriculture. So that means the more fuels you produce with bioenergy, the more likely it is that the prices for food will rise and that there's not enough food for the whole population. So now let's go back to the nice picture from Germany, these wonderful yellow fields here, and let's look at the production of biomass quantitatively. So if you have fertilizers and you do a good farming from such a rapeseed field, you can produce biodiesel with a yield which is about 0.14 liter per square meter and year. So that means for every square meter of your field, you have a big glass full of biodiesel at the end. Now you can convert this number into an energy yield. The heat value of biodiesel is about 37 megajoule per kilogram. Then you need the density to convert the liters into kilogram, and then you can calculate that the energy yield of such a field is 4.6 megajoule per square meter and year approximately. Where does this 4.6 megajoule come from? Well, this energy comes of course from the sun. The sun delivers energy to the field can grow, and then you harvest it and you use it as energy fuel. The solar input power in this area of Germany is something we can calculate with the information we had in the previous lectures. What we need is the field is basically horizontally, so we need the global horizontal irradiation of the sun. This is about 1000 kilowatt hours per square meter and year in Germany. And if you convert kilowatt hours into megajoule, you get 3750 megajoule per square meter and year. If you now compare the energy yield of your biodiesel to the energy input of your solar energy, you can calculate the overall efficiency. And this is the upper number divided by the lower number. So this makes a very small efficiency of 0.12%. What does it mean? It does mean that if you harvest rapeseed and you produce biodiesel from it, only 0.12% of the solar energy is converted in something which you can then use to drive your car. So this is a very small number if you compare it to photovoltaic. If you put photovoltaics on a field like shown here in this picture from lecture 24, you find out that you have about 200 times the useful energy per square meter compared to the field of rapeseed. There are a few more things you have to discuss when you talk about a comparison of efficiencies. The negative thing for the biomass is that, of course, you need a lot of work to do. You have to do the farming, you have to do the harvesting, and you have to have a factory which produces the diesel out of your rape seeds. And of course, you need a lot of additional material, which are the fertilizers, and also a lot of additional energy, because you have to run the machines from the farmer, the machines for the fertilizer production, for the diesel production. People have estimated that about 30% of the harvested energy from the biofuel is used for the production of the fuel. So there you get again a reduction of the efficiency. If you include that, you are well below 0.1% efficiency from the energy point of view. Of course, on the contrary, you have the photovoltaics. There is almost no operation costs. There is almost nobody needed. You can just use the electricity which comes out there. There's nobody which has to work for harvesting it. There might be a few people cleaning the PV modules and taking care about the operation. But of course, it's not the same as doing the work of a farmer every year again. Another important difference is that the PV field, of course, you can put into a desert where there's no water, whereas a rapeseed field, of course, needs an area where there's also water, and therefore also are different types of agriculture possible. The positive point about biomass, of course, is that you do not have these big investments. Some 10 years ago, photovoltaic was really still very expensive and also energy intensive. All that became much better nowadays, so that nowadays, of course, you have to re-evaluate if biomass is still a valid method for use. And there, of course, you find out that the biodiesel you can use for things where you cannot use the electricity for so easily. So it has a special application. For example, biodiesel can be stored, whereas electricity from PV is more expensive to store. Biodiesel can be used as a jet fuel, for example, whereas electricity directly cannot be used as a jet fuel. So in this sense, of course, you have to evaluate those things in more detail, and you cannot just compare it by the efficiency of the energy conversion. From that, I would conclude that there is no easy answer to how good or bad biomass is, especially as there are so different ways to do it. But of course, you can have some general guidelines from that. Coming back to the fuel and plate discussion, of course, I would say the most important point of biomass and agriculture in general is to feed the human beings and to feed the livestock, because there is no technical alternative for that. And in the livestock, we can, of course, also include our cats and dogs, because I know some of you will like either the one or the other. And if you look how much meat, for example, a dog eats every day, this of course also makes a significant part of the food. The next point then is construction material, because I think it's clear that if we want to have a sustainable world, we have to go back to renewable construction material. There we have to go back what we know from thousands of years ago. We can use especially wood for construction of houses and many other things. But of course, there's a lot more possible nowadays, not only cotton for clothes, but a lot more things are possible to construct on the basis of biomass using modern chemistry, for example. The next category where we need biomass and agriculture is as a source for carbon in chemical industry and also in synthetic fuels, because we have to replace crude oil, which nowadays makes up a lot of the chemical industry. And then if you remember lecture 14, there I showed you the idea of black carbon sequestration from biomass. This, I think, is very important, and there we should, of course, use all kind of biomass to do pyrolysis and similar things and store the carbon in the ground. And as we learned in lecture 14, with that we can rethink agriculture and replace part of the fertilizers and pesticides if we do more sustainable agriculture. And this black carbon sequestration is a cheap way to reduce CO2 in the atmosphere. Only after these steps, which are marked in green here, I would come to the position to say that then if there is enough biomass available, then we should also use it for as energy source. And here I also distinguish if you either want to use the energy directly, for example, to produce electricity, or what I believe is much more important, that you use the valuable biomass which you can store as a long-term storage material. So for example, producing methane and storing the methane in big storage devices, in big tanks, and then you can produce the electricity on demand from it. Whereas other sources like sun and wind would need additional electricity storage, which is expensive. So the message here is, if you produce bioenergies, make use of it in the best way by using it as a storage material. And please don't mess up the biodiversity with it just for the energy hunger of the world, because you can much more easily produce energy from wind and sun And on the next slide here, I show you another way of distinguishing between different types of bioenergy. The best way to use bioenergy is if you use it from biomass, which is a byproduct, a residue or a waste product of either farming or animal husbandry or forestry. So if you anyway do agriculture for feeding or for building houses, then of course you can use all the byproducts to produce bioenergy. And there you have no competition between fuel and plate. You might even have a synergy between them. The next point where you can use biomass without competition is if you have areas where there are lots of plants self-growing without any direct agricultural use. Of course, if there's a huge area which is full of bushes and they grow fast and you don't want these bushes, of course you can use this area for producing biomass in a cyclical way. And the only part which I see critical is if you have biomass, for example, biogas or bioalcohol production in a dedicated intensive agriculture where you have to use fertilizers and herbicides and where you really are in competition with food production. There I would be hesitant to produce biomass. So now we are almost at the end and I want to tell you a bit more details about bioenergies and their final product. I'm not a biologist, so don't expect from me that I explain you all the details. There are other people which can do that much better, but still I would like to give you a general overview here. So what are plants made up, or animals also? You can also use animals for energy production. Well, they are basically made out of carbohydrates, which means sugar, cellulose, and a lot of other parts of the plants. And the second type of material which you make use of in biomass production is a fat, so in kind of oils or lipids. And with these two basic elements, then you can make all kind of bioenergy. And here you see the biodiesel, which we discussed already. This replaces diesel. This comes mainly from fats in animals or oils and vegetables. There's a long list of plants and microorganisms which produce that and which you can make use of. I will come to an example later. The second class of products is ethanol, so it's alcohol. That replaces your gasoline in your car. It's normally produced by microorganisms and enzymes through fermentation of sugar or other carbohydrates. And then the third very important part of bioenergy is biogas. Typically it's methane. This replaces natural gas, and this is typically produced from microorganisms through anaerobic digestion of anything which is biodegradable. So this is a very broad field which you can use at a large scale. There are many more examples. You can produce syngas or hydrogen and many other stuff from plants, but I don't want to go into all these details. Instead, I want to show you a few more examples. We had already the rape seeds to produce diesel, and a similar thing can be done with Yatropha coccus. This is my favorite plant. Why is that? Because I was thinking so much about deserts and using solar energy in deserts. And if you think about that, the desertification is increasing all the time. There's a question on how can you stop it? And to my mind, this Yatropha coccus is a way to stop desertification. Why is that? Because this plant grows almost everywhere. You can grow it in wastelands, in saline and sandy soils. And it still works. Of course, also for these plants, you need water. And if you want to have a fast growing and a high production, you need a lot of water. But if you want to have plants in these areas at all, it also grows with little water. These plants produce nuts, and this nut can be used for diesel production in a very simple way. So you can basically use the oil in these nuts directly for your diesel car. You can also improve it and you can make jet fuel out of it. There have been big planes using this kind of oil as a jet fuel. But of course also here the efficiency is small because only the nuts are used for energy. You can of course use the rest of the plant and you can do pyrolysis and black carbon sequestration and make terra preta out of it, and then the terra preta in the ground over the decades will improve the soil, and then at some point you might be able to grow other things in this area. So this was always my favorite plant to reverse desiccation. I don't know how well it works in reality. That is something for people more knowledgeable about plants than me. Here we have a second example. This is a bioethanol factory in Brazil. So they produce alcohol from sugarcane. And in this factory, of course, you need a lot of electricity, and the electricity is produced by the trash of the canes. So this is called bagasse, and this can be burned and used to produce electrical power. I also show you this example to show you that from the environmental point of view, bioenergy is not necessarily the cleanest way from the amount of exhaust gases. All the problems with the burning of fossil fuel has also happen in a similar way if you burn biomass or biogases, at least in some sense. So in addition, of course, you have to discuss environmental aspect of this kind of energy. Another biomass which is very common nowadays is these wooden pellets here. These wood pellets can come from any kind of wood. And of course, if you want to have it in a sustainable way, you wouldn't cut down a rainforest for it. Instead, you can use what is called the short rotation forestry. So these are forests where you have small trees or bushes growing, which grow fast and which you convert into wood pellets and then regrow it again. Also here, you have to think about two aspects. You can of course do that on a field somewhere and leave the field alone for a year or two and then cut the wood. But of course you can also do it in a more intensive agriculture, which might mean that you like to put fertilizers into the wood and you might to water the wood so that the things grow faster and better. And in this sense then you have to rethink if it is then still sustainable or if this is not more like the intensive agriculture which uses a lot of industrial support. And then as one of the last examples I show you the biogas production, which is very common in Germany. You have these big tent-like structures of biogas production which are under pressure. In there you have the anaerobe digestion. This produces CH4. And then under pressure it comes out and can be put into the standard pipeline system of natural gas. Just one more comment to that, just to have a better understanding what is happening here. So you have microorganisms which basically eat up the bio stuff which you put in, which could be almost anything. And these microorganisms produce CH4, methane gas. And as a non-biologist, you would like to understand why this is possible. And this is quite easy to understand, just from the chemical point of view. As you know, biomass is mainly composed of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. If you burn biomass, a wooden fire, for example, you burn these elements and you produce CO2, carbon dioxide, or water, H2O. So in this sense, with the three elements, there's not much more to produce. If you have a lot of oxygen, you produce the oxygenized version of carbon and hydrogen, because this is the lowest state of molecular energy. What happens now if you do this in these blobs here, where there's no oxygen? Well, if there are these microorganisms which have to live Without oxygen, the only way to gain energy is if they decompose the biomass in a way where you do not need oxygen. So how can you do that if there's not enough oxygen in your biomass and there's no oxygen from outside? The only way to decompose it is that you take the C and the H elements in your biomass and somehow convert it. You can convert it either to pure carbon, that is what happens in anaerobe pyrolysis. Pyrolysis is also a kind of burning without oxygen, then you produce pure carbon. The second way to do it is that you produce hydrogen molecules, H2. This is also happening with some kind of microorganisms, but with the microorganisms which you use here in these bowls for biogas production, they use their energy by producing CH4, because that is the only molecule which they can produce if there's no oxygen. So this is the way how these microorganisms can gain their energy for living, and the end product of that is CH4, because that is basically the only molecule which you can produce from C and H without additional oxygen. So from this point of view, of course, it's easy to understand that there's mainly methane coming out. The same happens, for example, also in the digestive part of cows. When cows eat grass, the similar kind of microorganisms produce CH4, or in your own body it's also produced, and you all know the effect of that. Now I come to my last example, and this is something where we do not talk about land plants, but where we talk about water. So if you have a pond at home, if you have a small lake, you all know that at some point when there's enough sun and then there's enough microorganisms in the water, at some point the algae start to grow. They are green because there's chlorophyll in it, and they convert solar energy into biomass. And this algae then you can harvest. You can do it in an open pond, but of course you can do it also, as shown on this picture here, on an industrial production where you let the water go through pipes which are illuminated from the solar light, and then you can produce in a very clean way algae. This is called then a photobioreactor, because the light produces biomass in this reactor. And this way you can produce biomass, which you then can use for energy. Some people believe that this is the future of bioenergy, maybe also the future of feeding the world, because if there's no more land to use, then we have to go to the water. So that is the end of this lecture. I hope you learned something about bioenergy and biomass, and I hope to see you next time again when we talk about the next way to use renewable energies. Thank you, and see you next time.